that the sponsors in my life were like loving fathers, and that they knew that they weren't God, and that they just tried to be an instrument to get me pointed in that direction. And I wanted to say I'm very grateful that Jim speaks here. And see, I had no idea that Jim existed. And one day I was wanting to try something different, because the meetings that I go to, where I went to, I would often experience that there was an air of, like, I go to these meetings and feel like there was nothing else to learn. It was like there was so often being nothing offered that I started to get real disappointed and not want to go. And this is like a breath of fresh air to know that there's, you know, I knew there was, but to constantly get reaffirmed that there's so much more to learn, there's this much more to go. And it's good. It got me out of a good jam, and I'm all that there is to learn, I want to, you know, reach and get as much of it as I can. And it's, there's a good purity here, and I felt it the first night I came, and I hope to continue to come. Thanks.
All right.
I'm Mark Oliver playing this song. And this year has been the toughest for me, but it's also been the greatest, because somewhere it says that burdens are gifts, and great burdens are great gifts. And this year I forgot how to walk. I didn't want to walk. But I've accepted, I've learned to accept gifts, like so much love that comes from you people. Mm-hmm. And I can recognize things now that I never could before. And it's thanks to this program, and it's thanks to people like you, and it's thanks to guys like Jim, and that we keep coming back.
Tonight we're going to be taking a very close look at the 10th step. This step is a step of inspired genius. It's an incredibly beautiful step. The 10th step was not in the original bunch of, page 84 please, is not in the original steps of the Oxford group. And when we look at Bill's story in the first part of the big book, we find that Bill worked all the steps while he's still in the hospital, with the exception of the 10th step and the 12th step. Now, there's a good reason for the omission of the 10th step. When this fellowship was brand new, they were working with a bunch called the Oxford Group. And the Oxford Group had 6 steps which they used, and they were applicable in many ways to the alcoholic recovery. And our guys spent the first couple of years pretty much following the lead of the Oxfordians. The Oxford people that was a religious sect, an outgrowth of the Episcopal Church, the Church of England. And they had very specific ideas about how the Episcopal Church had missed the boat. When Henry VIII, King Henry, had gotten rid of the Pope and the Catholic Church and set up his own church because he wanted to get divorced, they kicked out quite a bit of the Catholic rituals and ceremonies, including confession. And because King Henry VIII thought that confession had been used as a means of extorting large sums of money out of people and getting dispensations and all that kind of stuff. So he said, no, we'll not have any more of that. But the Oxford people thought that confession was good, and they felt that it came from the Bible and was not only biblical, but that it went all the way back into all of the ancient religions. Everybody recognized how important it was to admit our faults to another human being, that this was a highly spiritual thing. And so, among other things, they reinstituted the idea of making confession to another person, not only to God or to Jesus or Muhammad or Allah, whoever, but also to another person. And these guys had it in mind that if you followed their 6 steps of recovery, that you would reach a state of perfection. And this was kind of a watchword with them. They truly believed that they, after working these 6 steps, became perfect. Well, our guys found out that that was not so for them. They weren't quarreling with the religious members of that sect, but they realized that for them, there was no such thing as perfection. And as Maris just read, perfection is not part of what we believe we will arrive at. We're looking at making substantial progress, but we're not looking at becoming perfect. And so what had happened, and the reason that they became convinced that the Oxford people were wrong with respect to at least this one concept of theirs, that they realized they didn't become perfect, and they, moreover, they realized that though God had taken from them the defects of character which they brought in the door and had helped them to be relieved of their guilt and remorse and shame for the things that they had done to harm others, and had helped them become unblocked from Him so that they were able to enter the world of spirit and they were able to have a spiritual awakening, that they realized that going out into the world and being out there, the world and all of its people would continue to threaten them. And of course, threat then equals fear. And fear, we now know, is the progenitor, the trigger mechanism for all of our defects of character, that it warps and perverts and twists our natural God-given instincts so that our minds stop working as God intended, that we become nuts, insane. God has restored us to sanity, as we're going to read in a few minutes, but this is not a permanent situation. It requires of us that we continually be vigilant. And so they said, okay, now what do we do? We know that we're going to have to find some way to take care of these things when they recur, because we found out that we can't expect to stay perfect. And so they said, well, wait a second here, guys, looky here. We've already got all these tools that we've learned how to use. And they worked. They worked to take away our defects. They worked to take away our guilts. So let's take these tools and let's learn to use them every day. And we're probably going to have to do this for the rest of our lives. So let's first decide that we're going to take inventory every day. And we're going to watch for those four cardinal defects: resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. The same defects that we found in the fourth step and admitted in the fifth step. So we're going to inventory those. So we're going to use the tool of the fourth step. And then we've already learned that in order for us to be set free from these things, it was necessary for us to admit them. And so we're going to tell somebody about what we have discovered, which is our fifth step. And then we will take them to God and ask God to remove them, which is our seventh step. And if we've harmed anybody, of course, we want to make amends quickly, which is our ninth step. And then furthermore, we've already learned that one of the most critical things we do is to keep our thoughts constantly on somebody that we can help. We're looking all the time to be of service to God and the people about us. So we're going to add the 12th step in. And then finally, we've come to a spiritual principle, which is love and tolerance of others is our code. Now, when we look at the 10th step, we're going to find that all of these things are incorporated in that 10th step. And they did this out of absolute necessity. Now, when the big book was being written and the steps were being written by Bill in the latter part of 1938, the steps had never been written down before. They were an oral tradition, passed on from person to person orally, never had been written down. So when Bill sat down to write out the steps, he was inspired, as I think most of us agree. But one of the things that became clear was that through trial and error, this whole idea of the 10th step had taken root, and that the people who were in recovery at that time were using this or some variation of this idea of the 10th step in their everyday living. And so when he wrote the 12 steps, he The 10th step was natural. It just popped right in there. There's something else we need to understand about the 10th step. If you remember back in the 3rd step, when we were looking at that paragraph that's just above the prayer, we found out something of extreme significance and importance, that God would provide for us everything we need. Everything. But that there are two things we had to do. One was to stay close to Him, and the other to perform His work well. Well, now, staying close to God means, does it not, that we must be free of the things which block us from Him. And so now we begin to see the real significance of the 10th step is that it allows us, as we go through each day, to stay free of the things which would block us from God, and therefore to stay close to Him. And this process is carried forward into the 11th step, where through prayer and meditation and inventory, we continue this. We continue to grow in our spiritual life. And then, of course, to perform His work well, this means our 12th step, doesn't it? So you take all this stuff, put it together, you find out that what's happened, what we were learned back there in the 3rd step has now come to fruition. That is to say that we're now in a place where we have gotten close to God, now we must stay there. And we must perform His work well. This means then that we look at the 10th, 11th, and 12th steps and we see that they're all of a piece. They're not separate entities at all. As a matter of fact, guys, it's quite clear that none of these steps stand alone. You can't just put them out here and say, there's the 10th step and ignore everything around them, because it just doesn't work that way. The 10th step absolutely depends on all the 9 steps that came before it. And it builds toward the 2 steps that come after it. And all these steps just hang together this way. They're all part of a fine mosaic. They're part of a continuum. And to try to separate them out, and some of our literature does that, this is folly. Because they cannot, it's impossible for them to stand alone. They're all part and parcel of this process, which takes us from a place of rebellion and defiance to a place of surrender and obedience. We call that the 12 steps. And so from that standpoint, then, we realize that the 10th, 11th, and 12th steps are those steps by which we continue to grow spiritually and therefore remain spiritually fit. And also those steps by which we fulfill our mission. Now let's go back again to remember what the big book tells us. That our real purpose here, guys, our real purpose is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. That's really why we're here. All the time when we got here, we thought we were doing this to straighten out our lives, to get our money back, to get our jobs back, to get our self-respect back, to satisfy the judge or the probation officer, and on and on and on. All that stuff of the world. We thought that that was why we were here. And of course, we recognized that alcohol and drugs were about to kill us, and we didn't want to die. So we were hoping that that would be fixed too. What we did not understand then, and we need to understand now that we're at the 10th step, is that we're fulfilling a part of God's plan for us, which is this, that we are to be of maximum service to Him. We are to carry His message to others, and we are to be of maximum service to the people around us. This is what He wants of us. This is our purpose in life. This is our holy mission. And until we really understand that and accept it as being true, it's very hard for us to stay disciplined and consistent in working our steps. We want to be able to say, aha, big sigh of relief, I finished those, now I can rest. But it doesn't work that way. So when we look at the 10th step from this light, we begin to see where it fits in. It's an utterly essential cog in our step life and in our spiritual life. Now let's take a look on page 84. There's only one paragraph which contains the 10th step. And then the actual step itself is contained in about 7 or 8 lines. There are 3 more paragraphs which follow, but they are not the 10th step. They describe for us what has happened as a result of working the steps. And they tell us what we need to do and where we're going from here. Let's start the 2nd full paragraph on page 84, right in the middle of the page. This thought brings us to step 10, which suggests we continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. Now, I hope that when we came to the fourth step and we were directed there to write an inventory, that we also figured out that an inventory is a written list. It's not something we do in our head. So therefore, it's very important for us to understand that the tenth step is likewise going to be a written list. And therefore, we acquire something along the lines of this and we carry it with us. And if Maris makes me mad and I get angry at Maris, I'm going to write it down. I'm going to pull out my pen and write down, I'm mad at Maris. Maybe because she did X, Y, or Z. She doesn't even know how to do that. But and if you think I'm kidding about this, I'm not. We got to get it out of our head and down on paper. That's why we learned in our fourth step to write it down. That's an inventory. It's a written list. Likewise, when we get to the 11th step next week, we're going to be discussing exactly the same thing. We learn to write. There's a little ditty which I made up. The more you write, the better you feel. I used to be a boy chorister. The more you write, the better you feel. Just remember that. We get it out of our head, we get it down on paper, then we can deal with it, guys. It's elementary, dear Dr. Watson. Get it out of our head and down on paper, then we can deal with it. So we're going to continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. So right away we recognize the fourth and the ninth steps, don't we? We're making amends and we're taking inventory. We vigorously commenced this way of living as we cleaned up the past. What part of vigorously don't we understand? That's not something that we say, oh golly gee whiz, I might kind of sort of do this every once in a while if I just kind of decide I might do it. This is something which is essential. It's an essential part of our continuing recovery. Now, there's a word in that sentence which is of extreme importance. We vigorously commenced this way of living as we cleaned up the past. What this means is that we make several amends and then we go immediately to 10, 11, and 12. Why? Because as we discussed last week in the ninth step, there are amends we're going to need to make that we may not be able to complete in our lifetime. There are other amends that it may be weeks or months or years before we're able to make them. Obviously, we're not going to delay doing the 10th, 11th, and 12th steps and instituting these in our lives, waiting to get our amends all made. So we commence this way of living as we cleaned up the past. Do two or three amends and then get with your sponsor and learn how to do the 10th, 11th, and 12th steps. We have entered the world of the Spirit. Wow, remember back in the fourth step? Resentments blocked us from the sunlight of the Spirit. We were blocked off, not only by our resentments, but our dishonesty and our selfishness and our fears. And here we find now that this has all been cleared away. Please don't listen to people who say that God doesn't take these things. He's got a sense of humor, he's going to make us suffer, and this and this and this and this. All we do when we put limitations on God's power is to limit ourselves, limit the results which we would otherwise have. And so we have entered the world of spirit. Those things which blocked us from God are gone. Our next function is to grow in understanding and effectiveness. Think about what those two words mean. We can just kind of slip right by them and not realize that we're looking at something pretty profound. Understanding. Where do we hear that word all the time? God as we understood Him. The God of my understanding. What does this mean? It means that we're going to grow in our understanding of God. It means that we're going to grow in our conscious contact with God. It means that we're going to be able to experience God working in our lives. And after all, the God of our understanding is the God we experience. We have never, most of us, I guess, have never seen God. at least not in this lifetime. And so we have only what people have told us, or what we have read, or what we've experienced. And for us in AA, most of us, the God of our understanding is the God who has come to us and has acted in our lives, and the God we've experienced. That's the God of our understanding. So we want to grow in our understanding of God and effectiveness. And effectiveness refers specifically to effectiveness in carrying the message. And that's why we do one of the reasons we do a sponsorship workshop, which is part of the program of this group, every Saturday at 1:30. We're all learning how to be more effective sponsors. So we're going to grow in understanding and effectiveness. And we continue to do this for a lifetime. This is not an overnight matter. It should continue for our lifetime. Take that "should" very seriously, guys. It means exactly what it says. We're not going to ever be in a place where we can get careless about preserving our conscious contact with God, because God is the only power that stands between us and the power of booze and drugs to kill us. We've arrived at this point now. And for us now to say, "Oh, I'm glad I got that done. Now maybe my sponsor will get off my back and, you know, I can go out and do other things. I won't have to mess with this stuff anymore." Wrong. I mean, if that's what you want, goodbye Charlie or Charlene, you're out of here. Because it doesn't work. And continue for a lifetime. The Big Book tells us, we're going to look at this in the next couple of weeks, that we're very undisciplined people. We have to let God discipline us in this way. We need discipline and consistency in doing this work. Now then, let's look to see. Where is our fourth step? Continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. Continue to watch means, in the context of the tenth step, inventory these defects when they come up. Notice that these are the same defects we found when we did our fourth step. The cardinal defects: selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. Notice the Big Book never, ever once even comes close to talking about sin, deadly or otherwise. Because we don't deal in sin here. We're talking about defects of character. And these defects of character are our natural God-given instincts, warped and perverted by fear. And they are a form of insanity. We're talking about unsound mind. We're not talking about immorality. We're not talking about sinfulness. We're not talking about who goes to heaven and who doesn't. It's got nothing to do with any of that. What we're looking at here is something very, very, very simple. These defects of character, this insanity, and our guilts that we brought in here with us block us off from God. They keep us from the sunlight of the Spirit. They keep us from recovery. They keep us from a spiritual awakening. In order for us to recover, we have to be free of them. And then, as we're finding out now in the 10th step, we have to stay free of them. So we continue to watch for these. And when these crop up, which doesn't say if, but when, we ask God at once to remove them. Seventh step. We discuss them with someone immediately. Fifth step. And make amends quickly if we've harmed anyone. Ninth step. Then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. 12th step. Next time we do this, we'll have neon flashers here. We resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. What did we learn back in the fourth step? Just as a for instance, because this is all the way through the Big Book. With respect to our sex problems, what did it tell us? That we turn our thoughts to someone we can help, because when we are helping them, this takes us out of the imperious urge, takes us out of ourselves, and it's the solution to much of our sexual turmoil, is to be seeking to be helpful to other people. And then finally, love and tolerance of others is our code. This does not say that we have a wonderful attitude of love and we have an undisclosed attitude of tolerance. It doesn't mean that these are things which we keep to ourselves. Remember that faith without works is dead. Love without the expression of love is nothing. Tolerance that's only a bunch of electrons running around in our head is nothing. We can't call those love or tolerance. Love is loving action. Tolerance is being tolerant. And so our code is to treat others with loving action and to be tolerant in everything that we do. That's our code. And understand this, code is not something to be, oh golly gee whiz, kind of nice if we sort of did. Code is a rule, it's a law, it's the thing, it's the way we live. It's immutable. It is a categorical imperative. It's an absolute. And please, 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 try to stay away from all this comparative stuff that's floating around out there as if we really don't know, but we sort of kind of think it might be this way. And let's temporize and let's just make sure that everybody feels good. I want you to feel good. I hear all the time people saying, as long as I'm comfortable, I know I'm okay. And I thought, oh my God. Wait till the first time the federal agents pick you up and drag you off to jail. Tell me then how good you feel. Now these next three paragraphs are very, very, very important. Some of the most important language in the big book. And they will tell us, the first paragraph that we're going to be studying right now tells us where we have come to as a result of working the steps. The next paragraph tells us what we must do for the rest of our lives. And then the third paragraph, the bottom of page 86 or 85, again tells us where we have come spiritually. And this stuff is so important, and it's so easy to just kind of skip through it as if it wasn't really there, so we get on to the 11th step. But it's real important for us to study these and see what they're saying. Much of what we learn, which is sort of like common wisdom around the rooms, is simply contradicted, in directly contradicted by some of the language here. And we're going to see that in just a minute. Okay, at the bottom of page 84. And we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol. Remember that love and tolerance of others is our code. For by this time, sanity will have returned. Aha! What did we come to believe back in the second step? That this power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. And that promise has now been fulfilled. In other words, the insanity which was our natural instincts, warped and perverted by fear, has been removed. Our minds no longer function in an insane way. Our whole attitude and outlook upon life has changed. And our minds now function normally, insanely. Sanity will have returned. We will seldom be interested in liquor. If tempted, we recoil from it as from a hot flame. Now, people are often talking about being tempted to drink and this sort of thing. And I often wonder when they bring that up if they'd actually worked their steps, and probably they have not. Because there will come a time, and I can tell you this for a fact, there will come a time when you never even think of alcohol anymore. The only time alcohol ever becomes an issue at all is when we're in a meeting and it's brought up. Other than that, it isn't an issue at all. We react sanely and normally. And we will find that this has happened automatically. Whoa, wait a minute, what's that mean? That's pretty interesting, isn't it? Automatically. You see, what the big book is telling us here, that because we have worked the steps through the ninth step, and we're now on our tenth step and perhaps our 11th step, that automatically we have been restored to sanity and that we will react sanely and normally. In other words, this is not something which we could force on ourselves. This is not something which was spoon-fed to us. This is something which happened automatically because we did the work. And we've got to understand that this is the way it's going to be all the way through. Everything in this program has to do with the work that we do, to follow the directions. And when we do the work, we automatically receive the benefits. Let's go back and take a look at the promises, 83 and 84. These promises are nothing more nor less than the inevitable result of working the steps. We're going to receive these promises whether we want them or not, provided we do the work. Kind of an interesting concept, isn't it? If we do the work, we will automatically receive the promises. One of the great promises is that we will automatically be restored to sanity. And then it goes on to say this: we will see that our new attitude toward liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. It just comes. That does not mean we don't have effort in working the steps. It means that we expend no effort in trying to not drink. Think about that for a second. We're not fighting with alcohol. It just comes. That's the miracle of it. It says we're not fighting it, neither are we avoiding temptation. Oh, but wait a second. If you go into a barber shop, you're going to get your hair cut. The last time I got a haircut, I was just walking by, and I was so shaggy, they snagged me and dragged me in. I had no intention of getting a haircut, but I did anyway. But that's not what... The big book doesn't play any of those kind of games with us. It says we're not even avoiding temptation. There are those of us whose jobs right from the get-go involve us being around alcohol and being around people who drink. But when we're spiritually fit, that's irrelevant. It's not anything that's going to tempt us to drink. Or even if it tempts us, it's not strong enough to cause us to do it. And so the later we're going to find when we get into the 12th step that the big book makes a real big point of this. That it is useless for us to try to shield ourselves from alcohol. And those attempts to do that have always failed. And why? Well, let's go back to basics again, guys. What's the real problem here? Alcohol is a symptom. The bottle is a symbol. The real problem is that we're spiritually bankrupt. And that we have no power over alcohol. We can't stop drinking on our own. And the only way we're going to experience sobriety, long-term sobriety, is to place God between us and the booze. That's the only way. At least that's the only way that Alcoholics Anonymous knows how to do it. And everything in our big book and everything in our steps is pointed in the direction of placing God between us and the booze. We want to jump in his pocket and stay there. We feel, it says, that though we had been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected, wow, look at this. We have not even sworn off. We've not even sworn off. How many times did many of us take a solemn oath? We'd never drink again. God, just get me out of this and I'll never drink again. We stopped doing that. What's the point of doing that? I know a guy, I don't know, I'm sure he's long passed into the great beyond, but he used to stay sober by taking a pledge once a year in church. And he was the most miserable guy I ever knew in my whole life. He was walking around with untreated alcoholism and fighting it every step of the way. This went on for at least 10 years before he finally succumbed. It wasn't enough. So we've not even sworn off. Instead, the problem has been removed. Go back to the fourth chapter. What did we learn there? The lack of power was our dilemma. that we had to find a power by which we could live, that is, as opposed to die. It had to be a power greater than ourselves. But how are we to find this power? And then it tells us that's what this book's all about. That's what this book's about. Its purpose is to enable you and me to find a power greater than ourselves, which will what? Will solve our problem. And here it tells us that by the time we reach the 10th step, the problem has been removed. It does not exist for us. It's gone. The obsession and compulsion to drink alcohol has been removed. It's gone. It doesn't exist for us. Maris read tonight the three pertinent ideas. Hark back to the third pertinent idea. Starting with the first idea that we're alcoholics, can't manage our own lives, and no human power is going to take away our alcoholism. But what? God can and will if we seek Him. God can and will if we seek Him. God could and would if He were sought. A perfect example of a very straightforward promise. Seek God, and God will remove from you, not can, but will remove from you the obsession, compulsion to drink alcohol. Will take away the insanity of that first drink if you seek Him. And how do we seek God? We work the steps. Pretty simple, isn't it? All this stuff is so automatic, you know. It's also straight line. Nothing is esoteric here. Nothing is metaphysical. It's do the work and get the results. You see, in the simplest possible terms, we find out what did not work, and then we start doing what will work. And when we start doing what will work, our whole life changes. And we say, wow, that really worked. Holy cow, this stuff is pretty good. Where's this been all my life? Why didn't I know about this? Well, these principles have always been around. But you know, one of the problems has always been that the principles that are embodied in the 12 steps, these are principles restated as steps of action. And they've always been around, but people, we would hear, oh, you got to be this and you got to be that, but nobody ever told us how to do it. Now we know how to do it. Work the steps. Practice these principles in all of our affairs, which means simply work the steps. In other words, the problem's been removed. It does not exist for us. We are neither cocky nor are we afraid. That is our experience. And here's the proviso, and this is the tough one. That is how we react so long as we keep in fit spiritual condition. And the big book tells us over and over again what we must do, and it reminds us and warns us that alcoholics are very undisciplined people, and we must allow God to discipline us in the way of the steps. Discipline and consistency every single day. And I'm talking to a couple of people here right now. Every single day. Today I went to a meeting. Here's the way you stay sober. So simple. Today I went to a meeting. Today I prayed. Today I meditated. Today I took inventory. And today I worked another alcoholic. Do those five things. Stay in God's pocket. You'll never drink. How simple can that be? Let's go down to the next paragraph, which is a paragraph which tells us what we must do from here on. It is easy to let up on the spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels. Oh, God, it is so easy. We begin to get the idea that we've got it made. Resting on our laurels simply means, as the ancient Greeks found out, to give you the laurel wreath for the victor or for the winner. And the victor or the winner, instead of going forward with their victory, take the laurel wreath off and sit on it and take a big rest. A big sigh of relief. I've won, so now I don't have to do another thing. Resting on our laurels. And we are headed for trouble if we do, for alcohol is a subtle foe. We are not cured of alcoholism. Whoa, wait a second now. A lot of people talk about having recovered. Yes, Big Book talks about that too, doesn't it? In the foreword to the first edition, it makes it clear. We are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. Nowhere is it stated that we have recovered from alcoholism. Alcoholism is an incurable, fatal, progressive illness. So we are not cured of alcoholism. We know that. But it is in full and complete remission, so long as we have God on our side, so long as we stay spiritually fit. So what must we do? What we really have, it tells us, is a daily reprieve, contingent upon the maintenance of our spiritual condition. In other words, our sobriety, our health, our lives depend upon staying spiritually fit. Period. And when we do not do this, we get sick. And when we get sick, we're just a step away from the next relapse. And we've got to understand that this is an immutable law. This is not something we can fiddle around with. You can shave here, you can skate there, but sooner or later it always catches up with you. Because we're dealing with something here that's far more powerful than we are. And until we learn that every day is a day when we must carry a vision of God's will for us into all our activities, which is the next sentence, till we learn that, we haven't learned the essentials of staying sober. How am I going to carry a vision of God's will for me into all my activities? Now we see the crossover to the 11th step. I'm going to, through prayer and meditation, I'm going to seek to know God's will for me, and I'm going to seek from Him the power to carry that out. So you can see how these steps tie together. And then finally, the proper use of my will. How can I best serve Thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. These are thoughts which must go with us constantly. By the way, must in the big book, and there's 62 of them, let no one fool you about that. And must means or else. It doesn't mean, oh golly gee whiz, it'd be kind of nice if you sort of did it. Must means or else. These thoughts must go with us constantly. We can exercise our willpower along this line all we wish. That means that I must will myself to turn my will over to God. I must make myself do it. The proper use of my will is to will myself to turn my will over to God and to do it as I go through each day. When people say, I took back my will, they don't know what they're talking about. What they really mean is they didn't give it. Today. This part of today. They did not take the action of surrender today. And therefore they found self raising its ugly head again. They say, I took back my will. No, no, no. You just didn't give it. You didn't take the action of surrender, you see. It's a fundamental concept that that most people just simply miss. The whole idea of surrender here is to take the action of surrender and to do it each day. What do you want me to do next, God? What's my next step to be, God? Thy will not mine be done, God. This is what we must do. It's the proper use of my will is to will myself, to make myself surrender, to turn my will over to God. It is not enough to take the third step, guys. This hasn't anything to do with the third step. The third step is a decision to do this. It is not the doing of it. When we ask God to take our will and our lives into His care, we are committing ourselves to do those things which we must do in order that He can take our life and will into His hands. We have to prepare ourselves for that. We have to fit ourselves to be of maximum service. We have to prepare ourselves to accept the flow of God's Spirit into us. Let's look at the next paragraph. This next paragraph is something we can meditate upon very fruitfully every day of our lives if we wish, because it tells us exactly what has happened here. Remember that we found in the third step that it was going to be necessary for us to stay close to God and to perform His work well. And we weren't close to Him then. We were still blocked off from Him by our defects and our guilts. But now, let's see what's happened. Last paragraph on page 85. Much has already been said about receiving strength, inspiration, and direction from Him who has all knowledge and power. Okay, this is what we asked for, wasn't it, in the third step? And now here in the tenth step, we find that it has come true. We're going to receive from God strength, inspiration, and directions from Him who has all knowledge and power. I often think about this when the subject in a meeting is humility. How in the world can anybody be less than humble who accepts the fact that God has all knowledge and all power? What does that leave for us that we can feel pumped up and prideful and egotistical about? Humility is the natural result of understanding that all power is a product of God and His grace and not anything from us. And we always like to consider ourselves as powerful and smart. Well, the fact is God has all knowledge and all power. Whatever we have flows from Him. Until we understand that, it is literally impossible to have a degree of humility that we need to have. Whatever it is, I have a friend in the Keys, and I go down there and visit him occasionally. And last week I was saying, "Wade, I want to thank you so much for having me in your house. It's really wonderful." He said, "It's not my house." I said, "What do you mean it's not your house? I could see the sheriff come to the door tomorrow and kick us all out." You know? He said, "No, it's a gift from God. It's not my house. I just get to be in it for a while." I said, "Wow, this guy isn't one of us, but he sure understands." There are a few people out there, believe it or not, who do understand what's going on. Okay, much has already been said about receiving strength, inspiration, and direction from Him who has all knowledge and power. Listen to this now. If we have carefully followed directions, oh my gosh, directions. Uh-oh. What about this business of suggestions, suggested only? Well, of course that's true, because you see, what the old boys were saying to us is, looky here, we did this work, this is the way we did it, and we recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body, and we've gone on to a life beyond our wildest dreams. We're suggesting to you that you might want to do the same. That's what the suggestion is. Same suggestion that you'd receive from the jump master as you leap out of an airplane. I suggest you pull the ripcord. Now, you may wish to auger in if you choose. But if you want to float down nicely and softly, pull the ripcord. So if we have carefully followed directions, we have begun to sense the flow of His Spirit into us. Now then, what did we learn back in chapter 4? That we were going to find God deep down within ourselves. It was only there that He could be found. It was so with us. That's what it tells us. And now here in the 10th step, after the 10th step, we're finding that we have commenced to sense the flow of God's Spirit into us. As a matter of fact, when you look at the 5th step, you will find that this process started all the way back there in the 5th step. And then, to some extent, we have become God conscious. Well, wait a second. There's a scurrilous piece of writing in the rear end of this book, where it belongs, called Appendix 2, which says that our more religious members call it God consciousness. Thank you very much. It's got absolutely nothing to do with religion. Each and every single one of us, as a result of working the steps, will become God conscious. We're going to be conscious of the God within us, the flow of His Spirit into us. And the next sentence goes even further. We have begun to develop this vital sixth sense. Think what that means. We now are able, because we are conscious of God's power, because we have cleared away the things that blocked us from Him, because He has flowed His Spirit into us, because He has restored us to sanity, because we've entered the world of spirit, we are now able to be inspired and to receive intuitive thoughts from God, which will show us the directions we ought to be taking. This means when we get into the 11th step next week, we get to look at this from the standpoint of we are prepared. in our meditation to be inspired, to receive intuitive thoughts, to know by inspiration and intuition what God's will is for us. Because we have developed this sixth sense, this tie with God. And think what the 11th step says, that we seek through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God. Because we've already achieved conscious contact. See how this works? This stuff is beautiful. And it's always the same. It's always, never changes. And it all relates back to one simple thing. Did I do the work or did I not? Did I follow the directions or did I not? And this doesn't mean the directions that come out of some treatment center or Hazleton or somebody's weird imagination. It means the directions in the big book. Exactly as they're written. Because, you see, the people who wrote it told us this is what happened to them. And then first they showed us how they got there. And they gave us the directions to follow. Why in the world would we do anything else? Why would we take a chance with our lives on the basis of somebody's theory or psychological mumbo jumbo? Why wouldn't we just pick up the directions in the big book and use them? When millions of people before us have already recovered doing exactly the same thing. Honestly, guys, I can't understand it. I don't know why people are so careless of their lives. I don't know. Each of us has a responsibility to ourselves and to God to recover and to carry His message. Not our sponsors, not our groups, not our counselor, not our facilitator, not our doctor, lawyer, Indian chief, or even our priest or monsignor. Our responsibility is ours alone. And it is a responsibility that exists between us and God. And so when we neglect our responsibility and we are led down the garden path by people who don't have the foggiest idea what the hell they're talking about, shame on us. And we've got it right in front of us. All we have to do is pick this book up and read it. That's all we have to do. Read it carefully, parse the sentences, understand what it says, and follow the directions. That's all. And regardless of who else may be out there who is trying to direct us in another way, we need to say to them, but you know, it all sounds really good, but where is that in the big book? And where's God in that equation? And if it's not in the book and God's not there, I suggest strongly to you to run like hell, because it's only going to delay your recovery or perhaps disable you from recovery altogether. There are people, unfortunately, who unknowingly are pushing others in front of buses every day. And we need to be aware that this is possible for us. Be on our lookout. Take responsibility for our own recovery. Read the book and follow the directions. And if you haven't got anybody in your life right now who will help you with that, find somebody who will. And I have to tell you this, is without bragging at all. I've taken over 2,000 people through the steps. And everything that I say to you, I know is true. There's no theory here, no philosophy. I'm not writing a thesis to get my master's degree or my PhD. I'm telling you what I have observed and what I have experienced. And I'm telling you that these things are the way they work. And when we do it this way, we do recover. We do recover. There are in this town right now about 40 people who have been through the steps following the directions in the big book, and as of tonight every single one of them is sober. And that's not surprising to me, because I know the power. One further thing, keep this in mind. Dr. Bob was the most honorable and honest of gentlemen. You read his story, and what does he tell you? Talking about the steps, he says, they never fail. If we go about them with one half the zeal we used to go out getting our next drink. That's simple. They never fail. And that's the truth. Every single person in this room is exactly where they need to be and never, ever, ever has to take another drink or drug again as long as they live. All we have to do is pick up this book and follow the few simple directions. That's all we have to do. Why don't we just make up our minds that we're going to save our lives starting tonight? And we're going to dedicate our lives to that holy mission, which is to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. This means that for once in our lives, we finally have a purpose. We're not just drifting around, letting the surf push us back and forth. We have a purpose. I hope and pray that everyone here tonight will do exactly that. A year from now, I want to see you all here, and 1 year more sober. That's what I want to see. Thanks very much. Our public relations policy is based on attraction rather than promotion. We need always maintain personal anonymity at the level of press, radio, and films. Now, let's start out with, let's parse this sentence and see what we're talking about here. First of all, the subject of this sentence is public relations policy. It doesn't have anything to do with things that we do with on an individual basis or even on a group basis. This is the relationships with the public, with the general public, is based on attraction rather than promotion. In other words, we're not going to be putting up billboards or running radio ads or doing anything to advertise AA to the general public. Rather, we will depend upon the attraction of the program and the success of the program to interest the people who will become our members. We need always maintain personal anonymity at the level of press, radio, and films. Now again, this is real important for us to understand that the traditions are not talking about anonymity. In any sense, inter se, that is among ourselves. We're not talking about anonymity at the level of the family or at the level of the business. Talking about personal anonymity at the level of press, radio, and films. And of course, today, TV. Which means that it's entirely consistent with the first part of the sentence, which is that we're not going to be promoting ourselves with the general public. And we will depend upon the attractiveness that our success with in achieving sobriety will have. And also, we don't have to do anything because there are people out there, and there always have been, who will want to write articles about us, and they do TV specials, they do radio specials, they do movies of the life of Bill, and so on. And all of those things are done without any effort on the part of AA. We don't promulgate these things, nor we don't encourage them. And they spring up without any effort on our part at all. For example, they learned how important this was because originally they'd worked out a deal with Reader's Digest that as soon as the big book was printed, the Reader's Digest was going to take the book and going to run a big article about it. And this was already something that these guys who wrote the book and who were publishing the book, and they had promoted this deal to get some publicity. And so when it came time, the publisher of the Reader's Digest reneged on the deal. He said, this is a family publication and there's too much in your book and in your program which has to do with the seamier side of life, and therefore we refuse to do the publication. And they were shocked, you know. They felt that this had effectively torpedoed them, because Reader's Digest had an enormous circulation. They figured an article in there would kick everything off, especially the sales of their book. You got to remember that when the book was first contemplated and first being written, that it was a commercial venture. these guys put together a corporation, and they bought stock in a corporation, and they figured this book was going to be an instant gigantic success and they'd all make a lot of money. So it was not some eleemosynary enterprise on their part. They wanted to make it as complete and as good as they possibly could, but they also expected to make money out of it. Of course, as all of this finally came down, they dissolved the corporation. And to whatever extent they could, they refunded the people's money who bought stock. And in most cases, the stockholders, the only thing they ever got out of it was a free copy of the book. And so the whole commercial venture was abandoned. But you can imagine at the time that the Reader's Digest backed off, they had stars in their eyes at that point. They figured it with Reader's Digest, they were going to sell thousands of copies of this book and make a lot of money. And so they were pretty discouraged. But then out of the blue, the publisher of Liberty Magazine published a small article, and that was pretty good. It was pretty complete. And then the Cleveland Plain Dealer, a newspaper in Cleveland, published a series of 7 articles for an entire week about AA, and literally kicked off the Cleveland group. They went from 15 members to a couple of hundred almost overnight. And then all of a sudden along came a guy who decided that he wanted to write an article about AA, and they brought him into meetings and they showed him the literature, and they met with him on several occasions. And finally he wrote an article which was then published by Saturday Evening Post. It's an excellent article. If you haven't read it, it's reproduced in pamphlet form, and a lot of the rooms have the pamphlet. It's amazing what this guy did. He really captured the spirit and essence of AA. Well, Saturday Evening Post at that time had a massive circulation, and all of a sudden they just went from dead center to huge. Now, they had all of the 5,000 copies of the original first edition, the first printing, were in a warehouse, and only 70-some of them had ever been distributed. And the only ones that were sold were the people who had bought the manuscript. Marilyn brought me a copy of the original manuscript from Akron. Thank you so much. And they had sold a few copies of that for $3.50, with the promise that if you bought the manuscript, when the book was published in hardcover, you'd get a copy of the book. So the only books that were paid for up to that point were the ones that the people had paid for the manuscript. Then all of a sudden, boom, Jack Anderson article hit, and it took off. Now, neither the Liberty article or the Jack Anderson article or the Cleveland Plain Dealer articles weren't anything that these guys had hustled. There was no promotion going on there. It was all spontaneous. And so they learned from this that we don't have to do anything to promote ourselves, that we speak for ourselves and the success speaks for itself, and that there will be plenty of publicity, and that we will become so well known. And the other thing that was important to them and is still important today was that we keep our credibility, that we not be shown to be glory seekers or power drivers, or that we're not seeking anything for ourselves, and that we're staying anonymous and not have no axe to grind. And that this means that our credibility with the general public, with churches, with medical people, with the government, our credibility is enormous, with the newspapers, all the media, because we realize that we're not trying to manipulate them or to gain anything for ourselves. And the media actually has been a whole lot more careful about preserving our anonymity than some of the members have been, because there are members who have really gone out and tried to trade upon the name. Now let's see what this says. Without his legions of well-wishers, AA could never have grown as it has. Throughout the world, immense and favorable publicity of every description has been the principal means of bringing alcoholics into our fellowship. In AA offices, clubs, and homes, telephones ring constantly. One voice says, I read a piece in the newspapers. Another, we heard a radio program. Still another, we saw a moving picture. Or we saw something about AA on television. It is no exaggeration to say that half of AA's membership has been led to us through channels like these. The inquiring voices are not all alcoholics or their families. Doctors read medical papers about Alcoholics Anonymous and call for information. Clergymen see articles in their church journals and also make inquiries. Employers learn that great corporations have set their approval upon us and wish to discover what can be done about alcoholism in their own firms. Therefore, a great responsibility fell upon us to develop the best possible public relations policy for Alcoholics Anonymous. Through many painful experiences, we think we've arrived at what that policy ought to be. It is opposite in many ways to the usual promotional practice. We found that we had to rely upon the principle of attraction rather than promotion. I hope that makes it clear to us here that the indiscriminate use of this term, attraction rather than promotion, carries much further than the tradition. Because this has only to do with, at the level of press, radio, films, and TV, or in other words, to the general public. It has absolutely nothing to do with how we function on a local level in our groups or on a personal level with other people. For example, a few years ago I was living in Colombia and I met Father Jerome, a Jesuit priest. He was a missionary father, and he's a member of the fellowship. And he had been tutored at one time by Father Joe, my sponsor. And so we got together and had a lot in common. And he said, Jim, there are a lot of cities here in Colombia that don't have AA. Would you be willing to help me try to get AA started in some of these? And I said, sure. And so we went down into the furthest southern reaches of Colombia, right on the banks of the Amazon River, where Colombia and Ecuador and Peru and Bolivia more sort of like come together, the headwaters of the Amazon. A little town called Leticia. It's a frontier town. The only way you get in there is by air, or you can come in by boat if you come up the Amazon River. And we flew in there in a DC-3, and a lot of the guys are walking around with guns on their hips. And at night when you're in a hotel and with the windows open, you hear the jaguars roaring out in the jungle and the big bull crocodiles down the river sounding off. It's a pretty interesting place. And so we were staying at a hotel there, and we went to the management of the hotel. They had a little conference room. So we agreed, we made arrangements to have that on a Saturday morning from 10 to 12. We went to the local paper and we took out a notice notice saying that if you're having trouble with alcohol, come to a free meeting at this hotel on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. And we figured that if we did that, maybe four or five people would show up. And it was amazing. Over 300 people showed up. And out of those 300, 30 formed a new group. And now in Leticia, there are four groups. So we did this in five other cities. Same thing. Put a notice in the paper, hired a hall. If you have trouble with alcohol, come to this meeting, free. And they showed up all over. And all six of those cities now have very active AA groups going. So I didn't feel the least bit bad. I didn't feel like we were violating the tradition by what we did. It was the way of quickly getting the word out to people, and it worked beautifully well. I suppose technically, and that's why I'm bringing this up, technically it probably is a violation because we use a newspaper for a notice. But man, I would do it again tomorrow if we had the opportunity. So that's pretty much what this 11th tradition is. Who would like to start the discussion, please?
I'd just say real quickly, Jim, with what I see in newspapers, the AA meetings are announced all the time.
AA meetings are what?
I say they're announced, they're published as to where they are, the times they are.
Well, this, but remember what it says, personal anonymity. That means each individual. Mm-hmm. Each individual's anonymity. It certainly hasn't anything to do with where the meetings are. Okay. At least the tradition doesn't. I mean, there may be some group consciences against it or whatever, but the tradition is not. Who's next?
I worked for a number of years in a liquor store when I was sober, and I took this tradition very seriously, because a lot of drunks would come in, you know? A lot of guys that I knew personally, and I never said anything. Some would ask me if I was in AA, and I'd say yes, and someone asked me to help. But I never volunteered. What's the matter with you? You're shaking like a whip. Never do that. And I think now, after hearing you and that thing in Columbia, that I really should have. That I really should have. So many people I sponsored were inviting to this. But I never said, come with me to a meeting, unless they asked me first. And I thought that I was adhering to this tradition, but I really don't think I was, because I think the common good, the better, supersedes the good. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you know, there's another consideration, though, when you're working for somebody. And before you would reveal your alcoholism and begin to proselytize for people to go to meetings and so forth, you'd sure want to pass it by your boss before you did that. And I don't know what your situation was, but other than that, certainly that there's nothing in that tradition that would keep you from cutting some of those drunks out of that herd and seeing what you could do to help them. Absolutely. And it's very effective, you know. You get, all it takes is 1 out of 10. That's about what we always got in Columbia. If we had 200 people show up, we'd 20 people would form a new group. Or if 100 showed up, 10 would form a new group. You know. About 10%. That's what we get around here. People that walk in the door, about 1 out of 10 will actually stay around for a long period of time. So, but that doesn't mean that we don't just keep pitching the program, you know. We just keep it up, because you never know who's going to respond. Never know. You can't tell in advance.
Hi, I'm Marilyn. I'm an alcoholic. Uh-huh. You know, in my life, the movie Days of Wine and Roses really had a big impact on me coming back. Because I watched that the day before I picked up my white show. And I was just wondering what, are there ever any comments about movies like that, or 28 Days, or, you know, any of the movies that are out in Hollywood?
You mean in The Fellowship?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Everybody talks about them.
No, I mean The Fellowship talks about them, but I mean as far as... Do they try to discourage them or encourage them?
Oh, no, no. We don't take any position on that at all. If somebody, like when they were going to do Bill's story, mm-hmm. the movie, New York cooperated with them, opened up the archives for them. Mm. We don't keep anything secret. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't any question about Bill's anonymity. Mm-hmm. And they, as a matter of fact, they weren't even going to use his last name. My name is Bill W. And so they preserved his anonymity, and New York was very willing to let them have whatever they needed to authenticate what they did. The movie was fairly close to being true. They took some artistic license here and there. I wasn't real impressed with it. I didn't think it had anywhere near the power that was available if they'd wanted to use it. It was more biographical than it was really showing what had happened with this guy, and what the results of his spiritual awakening, his epiphany were. I mean, literally, without that, there'd be no us. We wouldn't be here. Had God not seen fit to come into his life as he did, there's no doubt in my mind that Bill never would have gone as far as he went to get this thing started. He might have gotten sober himself, and he'd have just retired into anonymity, licked his wounds, but he was literally inspired and driven to go out and do what he did. Can you imagine any of us in that similar circumstance spending 6 months, starting tonight, out there trying to get somebody sober, and not a single person ever responded for 6 months? And Bill was inspired, no doubt about it, and driven. And it was only providential in everything. Think about what had to happen, Marilyn. First, Bill had to go to Dr. Silkworth and say to him, "Doc, this isn't working. What am I doing wrong?" And Dr. Silkworth said, "Well, I'll tell you what you're doing that's wrong. Is you need to first tell them about yourself. You can't just come up to them and say you're a drunk, get on your knees and start praying. You got to tell them what's wrong, what happened with you, because you have to gain their confidence, and you have to establish your credibility that you know what you're talking about before they're going to listen to you. After you have told them how you drank and what happened to you, and tell them about your bottom and how you reached that, they're still interested," then he said, you got to tell them what's wrong with them. He said, "I remember what happened because you were here for the second time in my hospital, and it's not coincidental that when you were leaving, I told you that you only had a year to live if you didn't stop drinking, and that there was no cure for your disease, and that I couldn't help you anymore. And I said, I know that got through to you one way or another. You had to understand that this was no longer something that you could take lightly. You couldn't play with it anymore. If you didn't stop drinking, you were going to die or go crazy. So you need to tell them what's wrong with them, because they don't know. And if they're still interested, then you tell them how you recovered, and you stress the spiritual freely. And if they're still interested," he said, "then you want to take them through the steps, just as you went through the steps in my hospital." So he said, "What you're looking at here is a new way of approaching someone. Rather than jumping all over them and insisting that they're drunks and that they need your help, get their interest in there and build up your credibility first." Well, now, because he had done that, when he went to Akron, and he failed, he fell on his sword, the business was a big failure. He went back to the hotel and he was going to drink, but he saw the hotel had a message board, a directory of churches, and when he saw that, he was inspired to believe that he'd better make one phone call to at least one pastor and see if he could find somebody to talk. He got hold of this minister, and the minister put in touch with Henrietta Sieberling, who had met Dr. Bob in the Oxford group at the time it was there, and he'd been trying to get sober with the Oxfordians and hadn't been able to. So Henrietta knew about him, so she put Bill in touch with Bob, and when Bill sat down and did exactly what Dr. Silkworth had said, in other words, he first told Bob his story, and he told him what happened to him and how it affected him, how alcohol, and how he tried to stop and couldn't. And he told Dr. Bob about the disease that he was carrying, but Bob didn't know anything about that. Then he told him how to recover, and it worked. You see, all this, the thin thread that everything was hanging by, that if any of that stuff was taken out of the equation, we wouldn't be here. There would be no way. And so, when you start to look at this, it gets a little bit, it's extremely interesting, a little bit scary, just how narrowly we miss not being brought into creation.